When times are tough, as they are right now for many due to the coronavirus, we need a way to challenge our negative thinking so that it doesn't get the best of us. Paul gives us some clues, I think, in these verses to how we can control our thinking and thereby our attitude and our outlook, rather than allowing our thinking to control us. So we're going to be looking at verses 8 to 9, just two verses. I'll read them, and you can read them there in your home or wherever you happen to be, and together, and then we'll get into our study together. Philippians 4, verse 8 says, "Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things, the things which you have learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word today, and we ask that your Holy Spirit would truly illumine our minds and help us to think clearly in these matters which we are about to discuss today. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me share with you a little story that serves to illustrate, I think, where we're going to be going with our study today. This story is told from the perspective of a duck hunter, and here's what he had to say. An optimist sees the best in the world, while a pessimist sees only the worst. An optimist finds the positive in the negative, and a pessimist can only find the negative in the positive. For example, as a duck hunter, he said, "I was in the market for a new dog, a new bird dog, a few years ago. My search finally ended when I found a dog that could not only retrieve, but could actually walk on water. Of course, I bought him immediately, but I wasn't sure how I would tell my hunter buddies. And so I decided to break the news to one friend at a time, starting with a longtime buddy who was also a hunter. He was a pessimist by nature, but I invited him to hunt with me and with my new dog. And as we waited and carefully concealed ourselves by the shore, a flock of ducks flew by. We fired, and ducks fell at a distance. The dog responded and jumped right into the water. However, he didn't sink, but instead he walked across the water to retrieve the birds, never getting more than his paws wet. This continued all day long. Each time a duck fell, the dog walked across the surface of the water to retrieve it. Well, my pessimist buddy watched carefully, saw everything, but didn't say a single word about it the entire day. On the drive home, the silence was suddenly broken when my friend said, "Too bad about your dog." A little surprised at his statement, I asked, "What do you mean?" "I mean," drawled the pessimist slowly, "it's too bad you got stuck with one that can't swim." Now, this guy was a real negative thinker, don't you think? Or wouldn't you say, actually? Don't you think and wouldn't you say? Someone has said that the greatest addiction in our society, that our society faces, is the addiction to anxiety. We talked about overcoming anxiety in our study, the last study in Philippians, a couple of weeks ago. Now, as we move into verses 8 and 9, we note a connection. In verse 7, we are told that the peace of God will guard our hearts and our minds when we pray rather than fret. Notice how the next two verses end. Let's look at verses 8 and 9 again. Again, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, lovely, of good report, if there's anything virtuous, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things, the things which you have learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and notice this, and the God of peace will be with you. The focus in both texts is on how to know the peace of God rather than just the churning of the world. Remember, verse 7 says, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. And then verse 9, and the peace of God, or the God of peace, will be with you. Verse 9 talks about the God of peace, and verse 7 talks about the peace of God. May I say to you that if you know the God of peace, you can know the peace of God. But at the same time, you can never know the peace of God until you know the God of peace. It's sad that so many really want the peace of God, but they don't really want the God of peace. They want the benefits that God offers, but they don't really want to submit to what God says is necessary in our lives if we want to experience real peace. In our last message, we looked at the importance of talking to God. And in a sense, this text challenges us in the way we talk to ourselves. What we think about and how we interpret the things that are happening around us create the churning that so often is a part of our living, the anxiety. There's a famous scene in Peter Pan. Peter is in the children's bedroom. They have seen him fly, and they would like to fly too. They've tried it from the floor. They've tried it from the beds, and the result is failure. They can't fly. And so John asks, how do you do it? And Peter answered, you just think lovely, wonderful thoughts, and they lift you up into the air. Now, I grant you, that sentiment is a little sappy, but it also contains a measure of truth. The only way to defeat evil thoughts is to learn to think differently. Now, what is particularly frightening about that in our culture is that it seems to me that thinking is not really that important today. We are not so concerned about thinking as we are about two other things. We're concerned about emotion, and we're concerned about pragmatism. We're concerned about feeling, and we're concerned about success. We are not so much concerned about thinking. In other words, people don't ask this question, is it true? And they don't ask this question, is it right? They ask these questions, does it work? And how will it make me feel? That's what they want to know. They don't want to know if it's right. They don't really care if it's right. They don't particularly care if it's true. But will it work, and will it make me feel good? Those are the concerns. That's really a tragic thing to face, but that is the nature of our society today. The mind is depreciated, I think, in our culture because we are into a feeling kind of a culture. Bill Hull, in a book entitled Right Thinking, written in 1985, writes this. He says, what scares me is the anti-intellectual, anti-critical thinking philosophy that is spilled over into the church. This philosophy tends to romanticize the faith, making the local church into an experience center. Their concept of church is that they are spiritual consumers and that the church's job is to meet their felt needs. And what is happening in the church is that people are going to church not to think, not to reason about the truth, not like the noble Bereans to search the scriptures to see what is true, but they're going there to get a weekly spiritual fix, a weekly spiritual high, so that they can feel that God is still with them. They are spiritually unstable because they live on feeling rather than on thinking. Not every church, obviously, and not every Christian who goes to church is like this, but there are many who are. And so the Christian must not be a victim of his feelings. He must not get caught in a pragmatic trap of, you know, does it work? Is it successful? Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 10:5, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. He speaks about bringing every thought into captivity. Now, isn't that amazing? We can go through the world and literally take every human thought captive to the truth in Christ, can't we? We can force it to submit to what we know is true about Christ, true about God, true about Scripture. We can do that. We have a new mind, the Scripture tells us. Have you ever strained anything through a strainer? We have the ability to strain all of the data in the world and to purify it. We have the mind of Christ, the mind of God. The mind of Christ is our strainer. 1 Corinthians 2:16 says, "For who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him?" But, he says, we have the mind of Christ. So the Christian life then becomes characterized by a new mind, by the ability to strain the things of the world through this new mind. We have a new mind. But may I challenge you? Have you ever noticed that sometimes your mind gets dirty? Have you ever noticed it needs a periodic cleaning? Well, in Romans 12, 1 and 2, it says that we not only are to present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is an act of reasonable worship, but we are not to be conformed to this world, but we are to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, in order that we may know what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. We are continually in need of renewing our minds, continually renewing our minds. Ephesians 4:23 says, "And be renewed in the spirit of your what? Your mind." 1 Thessalonians 5:21, "Test all things. Hold fast to what is good." And the opposite of that would also be true. Discard what is false, what is not good. So learn to think. Refresh your mind. Clean your mind. Renew your mind. It gets dirty in the world. Our thinking is something that we must take charge of. If we don't, it will control us. Paul tells us that we need to be intentional about focusing our minds. Our text today tells us what we need to be focusing our minds and our thoughts on. So first I want to look briefly at what the text says, and then I want to talk about a couple of principles for changing the way we think that I think will really help us in this critical area. So first, let's look at what the text is teaching us, verse 8. First, he says, "Finally, brethren, whatever things are true." He's telling us now the things that we should be thinking about, the things that we should be meditating on, okay? Finally, brethren, whatever things are true. If you want to know what's true, where are you going to go to find out what's true? Well, how about to the Word of God? At the front of our church bulletin, which we haven't seen much of lately because of this, COVID-19 thing that we're going through right now. But at the front of our church bulletin, there's a scripture. I wonder if you would know, if I asked you and you were able to answer me right now, if you would know what it is. Because it's on the bulletin. It's been there every, week since we started the church. There's a scripture there. Here it is, okay? John 17:17. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. Psalm 19:9 says, the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. Psalm 119:151, you are near, O Lord, and all your commandments are truth. So your word is truth. The judgments of the Lord are true. All your commandments are true. So the word of God is definitely a source of truth. And we could go on and on quoting these kinds of scriptures. The truth is in Christ also, according to Ephesians 4:21. If indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus. John 1:17, for the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. John 14:6, Jesus himself said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The Holy Spirit also is truth. John 16:13, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. The Word of God is truth. 1 Thessalonians 2:17, for this reason we also thank God without ceasing, because when you received the Word of God, which you heard from us, you welcomed it not as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which also effectively works in you who believe. So if you want to know the truth, you go to the word of God. It's the focus. It's the location of all truth. So if I'm going to think on whatever is true, then I'm going to dwell on the Word of God first of all and on anything else that is true, that is based on the Word of God. Secondly, he says, whatever things are noble. Notice that. That means worthy of respect. Whatever is noble, whatever is honest, whatever is reverent, whatever is lofty, not trashy or mundane or common. The word really comes from a term meaning to worship. Whatever is worthy of awe, whatever is held in high regard, whatever is greatly respected, whatever is worthy of adoration, that's what we are to think about. Thirdly, he says, whatever things are just. And the word is righteous here. Whatever is in perfect harmony with the eternal, unchanging, divine standard of a holy God revealed in Scripture. I'm going to think on what is true. I am going to think on what is worthy of worship. I am going to think on what is absolutely consistent with the holiness of God. And then he says, whatever things are pure. The Greek word means to be morally clean, to be undefiled. Whatever is morally pure, whatever is morally clean, I will think on that and not on the other junk. And then he says, whatever things are lovely. That means winsome or pleasing or attractive or amiable. It's one of those words that we only find here in the New Testament. It's an unusual word. It means whatever is sweet or gracious or generous or patient. It can have a lot of different facets to it. Whatever is attractive and lovely is as good as any word to translate that term. So whatever things are lovely, those are the things that we are to meditate on. And then whatever things, he says, are of good report. That means things that are well thought of. Whatever is highly regarded, that's where I put my thoughts. Now, you know where that keeps me? That really confines me, doesn't it? If I look around at the world, am I going to find the truth? If I look around at the world, am I going to find what is honorable, what is right, what is pure, what is lovely, what is of good report? In some places, yes. But not everywhere, and not in most places. When I turn on the television, is that what I'm going to see? Whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good report. When I go to the theater, is that what I'm going to see? When I read a book or a magazine, is that what I'm going to see? Again, in some places, yes, but not in every place, not in most places. When I have a conversation with friends, is that what I'm going to experience? The point is, you've got to protect your mind, because that is what determines what you want and what you desire, and that's what determines how you react to the stimuli of life. We must protect our minds. And then he says, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. And those are statements that we could just as well read, since there is excellence, and since there are some things worthy of praise, please focus on them. Please, your mind is the greatest treasure that you have in terms of those gifts of human life. And now, as a believer, your mind works in concert with the Spirit of God. It's not independent. As a Christian now, you have the Spirit in you, and your mind is working in concert with the Spirit of God. So you must protect your mind. And the way you protect it is how you think. You must protect its influences. You must avoid those things which negatively influence your thinking. And there's no easy or quick fix to any of this. There's not an easy formula to spiritual stability that you can get in, you know, like four counseling sessions. There's not any little book that you can read and say, here it is. You can't go to the store and get a bottle of it and take a dose of it a day. We would love to be able to do that. Attaining the peace of God is a product of refusing to give up. It's a product of cultivating unity in our relationships with others. It's a product of maintaining a spirit of joy instead of discouragement. It's a product of learning to be kind to others, no matter how unkind others may be to you. It's resting on a confident trust and faith in the Lord instead of worrying about things that we can't control. It's reacting to problems with thankful prayer rather than anxiety and fear. And all of that flows out of focusing on godly virtues that begin to dominate your thinking patterns. That's what he's talking about here in verse 8, these godly virtues. We focus on them, and they help to control our thinking patterns. That's what produces the peace, the joy, the humility, the faith, and the gratitude that make your life and my life stabilized. Now, the only remaining issue here, and Paul knows it, is to say, look, if you want an example of all of this, look at me. We love examples. We need examples. And so Paul is offering himself as an example. Verse 9, the things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, he says, and the God of peace will be with you. You'll not only have the peace of God from verse 7, but you'll have the God of peace, verse 9. Paul says, I'll be the model. I'll be the model for you. I wonder how many of us can say the same thing. I will be the model of these things for the other people in my life. Philippians 3:17, brethren, join in following my example and note those who so walk as you have us for a pattern. So Paul is saying, I'm not the only example. There are other people who are an example of this as well. Check them out. Note them. Be encouraged by them. Don't you want to be one of those people that Paul was talking about there? Note those who so walk. I want to be one of those people. And then in the next few verses, he goes on from there to give us illustrations of how he literally transcended his troubles, his persecutions, his difficulties, his testings, and in the process, he maintains the peace of God in his life. Paul was not somebody who had an easy life. He had an extremely difficult life. If you think your life is difficult, then you just take your life and multiply it times whatever large number you want to, and that is probably Paul's life. But he managed to transcend all of those things and experience the peace of God in his life. And remember, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he, according to Proverbs 23:7. So we really must learn to guard our minds. We cannot expect the fullness of spiritual joy and usefulness unless we desire the right things, unless we think about the right things, unless we meditate on the right things. And that's because it's our desires that move our behavior, and our desires are a direct reflection of our influences. So, brothers and sisters, he says, think on these things, meditate on these things. Now, I want to look at two general principles that are contained in these verses. We've already alluded to them, but I want to say them very, very specifically to emphasize them once again in our hearts and in our minds. First of all, we need to focus on what is true rather than what is not true. The word true can stand in opposition to many different words, actually. Something can be true instead of false. That's the obvious one. But something can also be true instead of fickle. As in, you know, we talk about a true friend. True instead of crooked. A wall, we talk about a wall that is true. That means it's a straight wall. It's not a crooked wall. It can be true instead of phony. You know, there are true Messiah, there is a true Messiah, and there are false messiahs, right? So which use of true is Paul really intending here? Well, could it be that he actually means all of them? We are to spend our time thinking about things that are accurate, that are genuine, that are reliable. In order to do this, we need to do at least three things. First, we must become aware of the falsehoods that masquerade as the truth. We must learn to think consciously. Now, I know that sounds redundant, but I don't think it is. We are being given ideas and philosophies all the time. They're being pumped into us. Sometimes we are aware that it's taking place, but oftentimes we are not. There are some things that we hear that we don't really give much thought to, and yet we receive them in our minds and we begin to react and to act based on those things. Have you ever awakened to a clock radio or a, you know, I don't know how many people use clock radios these days. They use phones to get them up. You know, they have your little alarm. Usually there's a nice piece of music that they have picked to start playing to wake them up in the morning. Have you ever found that all day long you're humming that song that was playing that woke you up? You may not have heard the song, but you heard it. Have you ever been watching a ball game on TV and suddenly found yourself humming the music to some commercial that was played? Not only are the advertisers trying to persuade us to buy their product, but commercials are also presenting certain values. We watch movies and television and even the news and don't realize that these things all affect the way that we think. Even our family and our friends influence us in ways that we aren't aware of. We need to work to make these messages conscious to us so that we can interact with them instead of just taking them in and not really doing anything with them other than just taking them in. We need to take these things in and we need to think about them. We need to interact with them. Now, what are you talking about, Dan? How do we do this? Well, I do it all the time. I think sometimes it annoys my wife. Try talking to the television and to the movies that you watch. If you're in a theater, don't do it out loud. Ask the question, what are you trying to get me to believe? Turn the television and the radio off if it's just serving as background noise, because really you're hearing more than you realize. Ask yourself why you do and think the way you do. If it's just the way I've always thought about it, then take some time to really try to identify why you think that way. Learn to ask the newscasters, is there more to this story? Are you spinning the story with your own opinion? I've come to believe that just about every newscast these days does that. You're never getting just the news. You're getting the news from this particular reporter's perspective with this particular reporter's opinion about it. Virtually every newscast today is an opinion piece. It's not just a newscast. Try to always find out the other side of the issue because it usually gives a very different slant on the things that are being reported, on the truth. So we must become aware of the falsehoods that masquerade as truth. Second, we need to be intentional about pursuing the truth. Paul tells us to think about the pure and to focus on the right. Folks, most of us, you know, we don't naturally think godly thoughts. I know you'd like to think that you do, or you'd like to think that your dear old grandmother did. I did about my grandmother. I thought my grandmother could do no wrong and that she definitely thought no wrong. But my grandmother and you and your, whoever it is that you idolize, they're human beings. They're just like you and me. They struggle with their thoughts. They struggle with their responses to situations. And so we need to be intentional about pursuing the truth. We need to pursue the pure things. We need to focus on the right. We have to work at this. It doesn't come naturally for most of us. It's somewhat like programming a computer. We must put good and true information in the computer before it is to be of any use to us. Obviously, the place to start in this is with the Word of God. As we meditate on the Word of God, we are anchoring ourselves to a truth that will not drift and is not subject to the whims of public opinion. We need to do more than simply read the Bible. We really need to get to know the Bible. We must meditate on God's truth. We must apply His values and direction to our life. Now, how can we do this? Well, obviously, we have to make time to do it. That's the first thing. We have to make time to read and to interact with the Bible daily. Memorize verses of the Bible so that you can have them when you need them and so that they can get deep into your heart. Go to Amazon or Lifeway or Christian book distributors online so that they can show you a number of Bible memorization aids. There's several good books that are out there that can teach you how to memorize. You say, I can't memorize. There are easy ways to do it. And so if you'll just check out some of these Bible memorization aids, they will help you. Discuss your day with the Lord. Talk to Him about the troublesome people and the situations in your life. Seek His perspective and then listen to what He says. Another way is to take notes during the sermon. I know some people are not really note takers. They just kind of want to take in the information, and I understand that. But I've found, for me anyways, that when I take notes, I retain the information better. It has more of an impact on me. I can go back and read those notes and remind myself of some of the key points. Read books that expound or point to God's Word. Make it a point to ask, what is God's perspective on this situation? You know, you can read nonfiction books that teach you the truth of the Word of God. Books maybe that are commentaries on books of the Bible or books that speak about issues of life and how to handle things, you know, how-to kinds of books. These can be helpful. But you also must be asking yourself when you're reading books like this, is this true? Is this really based on the Word of God? You can read fiction books, too, in the same way. Fiction books that are Christian-based can be helpful as well. But you need to be asking yourself, what is the truth that is being communicated? What are the values that are being communicated here? And you need to interact with it instead of just reading it and saying, oh, yeah, I get that. Yeah, that's right, that's right. No, you need to interact with it, and you need to ask yourself, what is God's perspective on whatever is being presented here? We must be diligent. We must be intentional about pursuing the truth. There is no such thing as static Christianity, Christianity that is not moving, that is not progressing. If you're not growing toward Christ, you're drifting away from Him. We must be intentional and persistent in our intentionality. So, we must become aware of the falsehoods that masquerade us, and we need to be intentional about pursuing the truth. Third, we must tell ourselves the truth. We need to tell ourselves the truth about our nature. We need to remind ourselves that we are created by and for God and that we reflect His image. But we also need to remember that we are sinners who have been saved by grace. How easy it is to forget this. It's so easy for us to start feeling that God is somehow lucky to have us on His side. And before long, we begin to believe that He exists to serve us rather than we existing to serve and to honor Him. We must constantly remind ourselves of our weakness, not because we want to beat ourselves up, but because we tend to understand our weaknesses and we really need to understand them better than anybody else. The person who has a problem drinking, or the person who has a problem with drugs, or with gambling, or with pornography, they really need to remember their problem. They need to remember how weak they are, so that they'll stay away from anything that might lead them back into their addiction. You and I must constantly remind ourselves of our addiction to sin so that we can combat pride and rebellion in our hearts. We need to tell ourselves the truth about our nature. We also need to tell ourselves the truth about God's love. Yes, we are sinful people at heart, but we are also sinful people who have been saved by grace, by God's wonderful and undeserved gift to us. You see, God cares about us. He loves us, and he has provided the way for you and me to be forgiven and to be transformed. He provided Christ's death as payment for our sin, and he has granted to us his Holy Spirit to help us in the process of our growth. We also need to remind ourselves or tell ourselves the truth about the circumstances of life. Do you know what creates the greatest amount of anxiety in our lives? It's drawing premature conclusions on the circumstances of life. We must cling to what we know and be careful how we interpret those things. Suppose a family member is delayed in getting home. They told you they're going to be home by, you know, such and such a time, and they don't show up. And so you begin to imagine all kinds of things. You imagine that they're in an accident, or maybe that they're having an affair, or that they've been abducted, you know, or any number of other things. You see, our imagination, we start imagining these things that we don't know are true. Chances are they're not, but we are reacting towards them as if they are, and our imagination robs us of our peace, and our anxiety builds. In times like these, we must remind ourselves of what is true. Our family member is late. That's the only thing we know. Of course, we could remind ourselves that this family member is a careful driver, that they are a responsible person, and maybe that they sometimes lose track of time. We could remind ourselves of positive reasons of why they're late rather than just the wholly negative ones. Suppose, as you've gotten older, you're finding that you can't do what you used to do, as I and others have discovered. Maybe you can no longer play sports with the same kind of, you know, give it all that you used to be able to do. Maybe you can't drive anymore because your eyesight is bad. Maybe you're having trouble getting around because your body doesn't work as well. Maybe you've had to retire because you just can't do the job anymore. It's not just a question of I'm retired because I want to retire. Maybe you're retired because you have to retire. At this point, there is a tendency to tell yourself that life is over for you. We can't do anything anymore. We start to feel sorry for ourselves. At this point, we need to tell ourselves the truth. Yes, we can't do what we used to do. But just because we can't do what we used to do, that doesn't mean that we can't do anything. We simply need to find different things to do and different ways to get around. Suppose you're heading out on a summer vacation. You get a flat tire, or you have car problems. Is it really true at that point that your vacation is ruined? Sometimes we jump to that conclusion, don't we? What is true is that things are not going just the way that you had planned them. The one approach, you see, spoils the fun. The other begins looking for fun in new areas. So, Lord, you allowed me to get this flat tire for a reason, or you allowed my car to break down for a reason. What is it that you want to teach me through this? What is it, you know, what new opportunity am I going to have because this has happened in my life? Who are you going to bring me into contact with that maybe needs to hear the truth that I have to share? The truth is that sometimes these unexpected things are really the most memorable and enjoyable parts of the trip, or they become that. If we can learn to train ourselves to focus on the truth, we will find that anxiety will be replaced with peace. So we must become aware of the falsehoods that masquerade as the truth. We need to be intentional about pursuing the truth, and we must tell ourselves the truth, not the things that we just think may be true. And that is how we focus on what is true rather than on what is not true. The second principle is we need to focus on the positive rather than the negative. Again, Paul tells us that we should think about things that are noble and lovely and of good report and praiseworthy. In other words, we should turn away from dwelling on that which is offensive and dirty and negative. Even those outside the church, by and large, understand this principle. One of the most popular management books of recent years is called Fish. It's a small book that tells the secrets that the Seattle Fish Company learned that made their business fun and effective and more profitable. And the first secret to their success is that they understand that they choose the attitude that they have toward their work. You know, we can moan about our jobs. We can complain about how little we get paid. We can simply endure, or we can choose to enjoy. We can choose to make work fun. We can choose to focus on the service that we can extend or the benefit that we can provide, and we can take pride in the product that we produce. It's a matter of where we choose to set our mind. We choose the way that we respond to our circumstances. We can see everything as a tragedy, or we can view things as a challenge, as an opportunity. We can see obstacles or opportunities. We can focus on our inability, or we can focus on God's great sufficiency. It's our choice, and we need to remind ourselves of this. Same is true of people. We can spotlight their failures or their victories, their strengths or their weaknesses. Paul says that we should look for the good in others. We choose how we will see others. Have you ever stopped to listen to yourself? How much time do you spend spotlighting the weaknesses of others compared to talking about their strengths? I'm sure that most of us spend more time on the negative than we care to admit. Why is that? Why do we feel superior when we are tearing someone else down? How are we better off for ridiculing the weaknesses and the quirks of others? Paul tells us that we should celebrate and that we should spotlight people's progress rather than their weakness. We should try to catch people doing things right rather than harping about the things they do wrong. We all have our rough edges. We all let people down. But beating each other up over these things doesn't help anything. When we focus on the negative, several things happen. We develop a critical spirit rather than a positive spirit. We push people away rather than draw them closer. We hinder unity in the body of Christ by forcing people to choose sides rather than working together. We are a poor witness for the gospel. We reveal that we lack love, and we are inviting others to be critical of us. When we are critical of others, we are inviting them to be critical of us. What is the upside to a negative spirit? There is no upside. But when we are positive toward others, we spur people on and we give them courage and we give them strength to continue. We build a spirit of appreciation and oneness in the body of Christ. We find that people begin to open up to us, and we discover some incredible treasures in the people around us. We find that people begin to speak well of us as we speak well of them. People try harder, and they are encouraged more. Conflict and churning and anxiety gives way to laughter and joy and peace. And best of all, folks, when we act this way, God smiles. God smiles. Sure, there's lots more that we could say, and there's even more that we can learn about this. But hopefully, we have enough to start working on. Are you living in God's peace, or are you constantly churning? Where do your thoughts go when you have idle moments? Do you wallow in godlessness, or are you feeding on the truth? Are you a negative person or a positive person? Do you build people up, or do you tear them down? Are you evaluating the messages of the world that they're subtly sending your way? Are you intentional about filling your mind with the good and the pure and the valuable truth of God? You know, I can't imagine that there isn't a single one of us who doesn't need a little improvement in this area. Ask God to help you and to help us. And maybe we can actually help each other. To make this work, I'm talking about the helping each other part, to make this work, we sort of need to give certain people the permission to challenge our negative and our overly critical thinking. And we need to challenge ourselves for sure. We might not like it at first, but if when we saw the negative and the destructive and the horrible thinking creeping up in our minds, if we said things like, hey, did you make a conscious decision to go grumpy today? Did you wake up on the wrong side of the bed? You know, would you call that a positive or a negative comment? We need to ask ourselves that question, and then we need to give other people, certain people, not everybody, but certain people, the permission to ask us those kinds of questions. Do you think that you may be jumping to conclusions ahead of the facts? Is this really true, or is this just something that you are, your imagination is, you know, making you think is true? I hope you get the idea. Maybe you should give other loved ones, again, the permission to ask you these questions. It would be annoying at first. It would be. I am annoyed by it from time to time. Sometimes, though, after I've thought about it, I realize, yeah, no, that was a good question, and I was, in fact, doing that, and I need to repent of it. I don't want to be a negative thinker. I really don't want to be. I'll be honest with you, I tend towards that, but I don't want to be. I want to be a godly thinker. I don't want to suck the life out of a situation. I want to infuse life into the people and to the circumstances around me. I don't want to be a joy stealer. I want to be a joy giver. I want to stand for that which is pure and not cave in to that which is not. I want to choose the good. I want to enjoy the beautiful. I want to pursue the noble, and I want to walk in the sweetness of God's peace. Instead of being Mr. Gloom and Doom, I'd like to be Mr. Faith and Hope. So I hope you will encourage me to think better thoughts, to engage in the right kind of thinking. I may grumble at the time, but I'll be grateful eventually. And I hope the same can be said of you. Let's pray together. Father, again, we thank you for your word, and we thank you that this passage really holds the keys to how we can get over the negative thinking that seems to dominate us much of the time, and help us to think more positively and to think more hopefully and to think more joyfully. I know that each of us listening to this really want to do that, and I pray that you will help us to do that by your Holy Spirit. But as we said at the beginning, if we want the peace of God, we need to have the God of peace. So I pray for anybody that might be watching that realizes that they really don't have the God of peace. And I want to ask you, if that's you, if you want to know how to know the God of peace, I want to just tell you it's pretty simple. You need to acknowledge that you're a sinner, and you need to repent of that sin, and you need to confess it before God, and you need to ask him to forgive you. And if you will do that, and if you will surrender your life to him, if you'll say to him, Lord, take my life and make it what you want it to be, he'll do that. And you'll have the God of peace, and you'll also have the peace of God. So I would just ask, if that's you, if you'll pray this prayer with me, then I pray that God will give you the strength to do that. Father, I know that I'm a sinner, and I know that I need you. I know that my sins have separated me from you. So I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to help me to begin to live for you. I want to turn my life over to you. I want to start being the kind of person that you want me to be, instead of the one that I obviously have been that has led me in the wrong direction. I pray that you would forgive me, and I pray that you would help me. I need your help. Give me your strength. I give you my life, and I thank you for forgiving me. In Jesus' name.